You are listening to Radio Yesterova. This is the Start Prop Property Show.
Welcome everybody to the Start Prop Property Show every Wednesday between 12 and 1 right here on Radio Eersterivier. Ons stasie, ons talent, ons mense. En vandag praat ons weer behuising en ons praat weer subsidies en ons praat hier oor die titel aktes en ons praat van die akteskantore. Everything to do with real estate, everything to do with property. This is the show to tune into, the Start Prop Property Show every Wednesday between 12 and 1. I'm Ivan Yetling, the principal of Start Prop Real Estate. And welcome to the program today. We're going to be talking all things real estate, all things property. We're sharing with the community all the ideas, everything that's out there, what's happening in the world of property. So if you're an investor, potential buyer or seller, this is the program to tune into. If you're wanting to get into the housing market, housing space, come and talk to us. Shop number 5, Rose Center in Plain Street in Blue Downs, right opposite the Pick and Pay. We are waiting for you to step into our offices, come and have a chat, come and have a coffee and talk to us about how do you acquire your first bond, how do you, how do you get your mortgage bond, how do you, if you want to rent out your property and you want to manage your rentals, if you want to apply for a first-time home subsidy, whether it's the old FLIS subsidy, come and chat to us. We're more than willing to share ideas about real estate and real estate investment with you. Today we're focusing on quite a few things. We're looking at, there's so many people that ask the question, I've signed the offer to purchase, I've signed the deed of sale. What happens once I sign the offer? What happens when I sign the deed of sale? What is the process that then happens? And so, lots of people are unfamiliar with the transfer process, with exactly how long it takes and what the chain of events are when you're selling a house. So if you're thinking of selling a house, and you're thinking, how long will the process take me if I'm marketing the property and I want to sell the property? How long will this process take me? And potential buyers are also saying, if I'm wanting to buy a house, and I'm renting at the moment, how long will it be before I can move in, before I can own that property? So we know there's quite a few processes that are involved. And as we're saying now, you put your property on the market, you then get a buyer, the buyer qualifies and puts in the offer, and there the house is sold. And so from that time, We're trying to give people an insight in just in terms of how long it'll take to transfer the property and get the property from the seller's name onto the buyer's name and what are all the processes that take place. So I think the first thing is, you know, that we have to realize that, you know, working with property and working with real estate and land, it's obviously an extremely important purchase. It's obviously a large purchase, and there are many vested interest groups in understanding, you know, the movement of property and watching the movement of property. And one such, one of the organizations would be the FICA organization. And so FICA, the Financial Intelligence Center Act, would govern, the movement of funds, and every client that is involved in a property transaction, be it a buyer, seller, has to go through this FICA process. Even a landlord wanting to rent their property out, the landlord and the tenant have to be FICA'd. So there's a big interest from the state and this, from the FICA organization to see whether there's any money laundering happening, if there's all the regular transactions, if everything is above board. So that's a very important consideration when you're thinking of bringing your property to the market, or you're involved in purchasing or selling property. The FICA process is something that we cannot negotiate away. It's something that we need to be part of. And in terms of the FICA Act, what FICA is saying is that, you know, FICA in the old days used to be my ID, my payslip, my bank statements, and then I'm FICA'd, proof of residence, and I'm FICA'd. Today, it's a different story. We've had to up our game substantially in terms of the FICA requirements. So what you need to do with FICA is that, you know, as an estate agent, we are reportable institutions. We have to report this to FICA. And one of the things we have to do is know our client and also to assess what is the risk category of the client. So if we're dealing with a client and we're looking at the nature of the client's income and the nature of his business, we have to assess what is the risk category of that client and then look at what measures we take in terms of FICA-ing the client and proving their income and the ability to be able to buy property from a legitimate source. The income needs to be derived from a legitimate source. Otherwise, the responsibility on us as estate agents is to report that transaction and to go to FICA and say, look, we can't justify the income that this person got. But if it's you're buying the house, you got a bond, or you're buying your property from your pension proceeds, whatever, that's all above board, and we have to regularize that. We have to go through all of those things and just tick those boxes. So FICA would be interested in the sale of property and the movement of property from the point of view of looking at how legal the transactions are and what the source of the funds came from. And as I said, both the buyer and the seller, the landlord and the lessee will have to go through a FICA process, and we would have to see what is the risk category of that process and then use appropriate measures to FICA the client. So one of the other things that we also have to do when it comes to the buying and selling of your property, another government institution that is involved is SARS. So SARS, all property transactions are go through SARS, and SARS has to issue a certificate saying that, you know, the buyer and the seller have been vetted by SARS, they're okay by SARS, including the estate agent as well. So if you're in the process of buying or selling a house, it's extremely important that your tax affairs be regularized, that all your tax papers are in order and that your taxes are in order. Because one of the things that needs to be done is that there will be a check and also a notification to SARS that this client is buying a house the seller is selling the property, and we will then get a tax clearance certificate from SARS, and both the buyer, the seller, including as well the estate agent's details will also be listed on that. So in the transfer of the property from one party to another, when we're busy transferring the registration of the property to the new purchaser, all of these government institutions are involved. FICA will look at your FICA status, and SARS will look at your tax status, and it's important that your tax information is up to date. So one of the things that every good estate agent will do is when they are looking at the prospective buyer and when they're dealing with a prospective seller, one of the questions they will ask them is, in what condition are your taxes? Are your taxes up to date? Are your tax affairs regularized? Are you registered as a taxpayer? So these things have become important. And when you purchase a property, You'll also be asked to provide your tax number, so you have to be tax registered. If husband and wife are, let's say they're buying the house together, and the husband is working and the wife is perhaps at home, and then, you know, we need to provide SARS with information why your wife doesn't have a tax number, if she's not working, if she's not employed by employers. So all those things become important in the transfer process. Another institution of government that would be involved is also, of course, you know, the city of Cape Town, the municipality, the local municipality's office. And we need a certificate from them as well. And that certificate is called a rates clearance certificate that is required for the transfer of a property. When you're selling a property, you will require a rates clearance certificate. So no property can be transferred in South Africa unless there's a rates clearance certificate. So the rates clearance certificate is basically to say that this client's water bill is up to date, their rates is up to date, their electricity and other municipal charges and you know, everything that is required by the municipality to have your account cleared. And without clearing that account, without bringing that account up to date, you cannot then achieve a rates clearance certificate. So the important thing here is, you know, there are many people who don't have a rates clearance certificate. You know, their rates is not up to date. And, you know, their water, there's an account and they owe that money. They're still owing that money on the rates. And how will we then, you know, deal with that? Because obviously they are also wanting to sell their property, but they have an amount of money outstanding on the rates. And so that we need to look at how we going to deal with that, because without the rates clearance certificate, as we said, we can't transfer the property. And perhaps the people don't have the money. They don't have the arrear rates and the arrear monies to pay the rates and to get the rates account up to date. So we need to find a way, because as I said, without the account being up to date, you can't transfer the property. So we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to talk about how we cover the outstanding rates. If there's an amount owing to the city of Cape Town or, you know, on your rates account, how do you actually cover that so that you can eventually transfer the property and then get the proceeds of the sale? So we're going to take a break now with the UCT Big Band playing Burnt Toast. And after that, we'll come back and talk a bit more about the transfer process.
This is the Start Prop Property Show. Our station, our talent, and our people. You are tuned into the Start Prop Property Show.
Yes, welcome back to the Start Prop Property Show. Every Wednesday between 12 and 1, right here on Radio Easter Affair. Guys, today we are chatting about all things property, and more specifically, we're talking about, you know, lots of people want to know what happens once I've signed the deed of sale. If I'm buying a house or I'm selling a house, how long does the whole process take to unfold, and all the things that it needs to go through, and what must I be ready for? And right here in studio to answer some of those questions, Rifaan Hendricks from Hendricks Incorporated Attorneys. And remember, Mr. Hendricks is the transferring attorney, the conveyancer. He's a conveyancer, and so he does that part of the transaction, you know, when the agents have signed the deal, they've got the buyers, they've got the sellers. And so now the file goes to the attorneys, the seller has nominated an attorney. And he said, look, you know, I know this man, this chappy, Rifaan Hendricks, I know he's been an attorney for more than 20 years. I want him to please attend to the registration of my property, the transfer of my property. And so, you know, the transferring attorney's job is really one to safeguard the interests of all the clients in the transaction, to see that this thing is as smoothly undertaken as possible. It's already a very nerve-wracking experience selling your house. Selling your property is a nerve-wracking experience. So what you really want is, you want somebody who can handle the transaction and take out all the mystical stuff, all the complex issues out of it, and to make it as smooth as possible. So from the seller side and the buyer side, look, they want to see the house registered and transferred as quickly as possible. The purchaser wants to move in, have a new house on his name. The seller wants to receive the proceeds of the sale, get the money, and move on with his spaces. So from that point of view, you know, we look to the attorney to facilitate the transaction and move the transaction along. From the attorney side, they have a whole lot of other considerations that they have to meet. They have to see in terms of the act, in terms of the Alienation of Land Act and all the other acts that are interplay here. You know, are we complying with all of the laws affecting the sale and the transfer of this property? So they are interested in other things like, besides the FICA, they're looking at the marital status, they're looking at the title deed, and they're saying, wow, look at these restrictions on this title deed, you know, were the people made aware of these things? They're looking at the financials, they're saying, is there financial closing? Are the guarantees in place, you know, to transfer the property? Is the money, the purchase price, has it been secured? And, you know, from an attorney's side, there's so much that they have to consider, and, you know, we don't always appreciate from our side, you know, what they do and the stress that they have to go through. And, you know, when he goes with his file to the deeds office ultimately to register and to lodge that the deed and say, look here, I'm lodging this file for registration, we have little appreciation for what they've gone through in building up that file and in coming to a complete conclusion. So, Mr. Hendricks, I've taken the listeners through the first part of it, and I've said to them, you know, in the transfer process, the first thing that we need to do is obviously account to FICA that this is not the sale of this property. The money that is involved in purchasing has not come from sources that are, you know, not regularized, not legal, tender, etc. And so the first priority you have to do is to FICA the client, and you won't start the job until the client has been FICA'd, both the seller, the buyer. And then you need to go to SARS, and then you decide, you know, is the tax affairs of the clients in order? Are the tax affairs of the buyer and the seller regularized? And, you know, I know, Mr. Hendricks, you were telling me that what SARS will do is, if the seller perhaps owes money to SARS and he's selling his house, that SARS can actually appoint you as an officer of SARS to collect on their behalf and to pay the money over to SARS. So that's not a very nice position for you to be in, where you're applying for a certificate from SARS to say, look, you know, I've got a transfer duty certificate, the house can go through, and then SARS notifies you, hey, these people's taxes are not in order. This taxpayer owes us money, and we want you to collect on our behalf those taxes. Mr. Hendricks, any comments from you regarding, you know, the onerous responsibility placed on a transferring attorney? I don't think we always appreciate the rigorousness that you have to attend to your files with, in terms of completing the file and getting the registration transfer process underway.
Now that you brought me back to that, good morning first and foremost. Now
yes,
that you first started out speaking about our onerous task or the task at hand, and then you took me through to some specifics with regards to taxes and compliances and some FICA, et cetera, then you brought me back now to the onerous task of at hand. So a few years ago, let me just take you back to a few years ago. deceased estates specifically. So the industry, or not the legal industry, people out there attacked the deceased estate industry, and they removed the sole right to do deceased estates from attorneys. Okay, they also attacked the sole right to do registration of transfers in the deeds office from the attorneys as well. But it is so technical and so legally technical, in fact, that they didn't see it fit for a normal...
The layman, yes.
Yes, to attend to the registration of transfers. So you have to be an attorney, and to boot it all, you have to be a registered conveyancer in order to register transfers at the deeds office. So not only, so you have to be an attorney to be a conveyancer. So you cannot be a conveyancer and not be an attorney.
Okay, so you have to be an attorney, and you have to have a special degree called in the conveyancing side, a specialist qualification.
You have to be registered at the... In fact, you register yourself at the High Court, or somebody registered you as a conveyancer at the High Court. So your name is registered in the archives.
Yes. So ultimately, the responsibility of the transferring attorney. What would, if you were to say in terms of a definition to the public, what is the role of the transferring attorney?
So the role of the transferring attorney, he takes responsibility for all the legalities on the document that he hands in, and he stands by the document. So the entire title deed, the entire power of attorney, is your responsibility, and you sign on it, and which means you take responsibility for the correctness of everything on that document. So you are the drafter. From the first letter to the last letter, you are the drafter, and you take full responsibility for everything that takes place.
On the title deed.
On the title deed. And all the
steps in between.
All the steps, every single step in between.
Mr. Hendricks, I don't think, you know, we appreciate the value of a title deed, of actually what that title deed represents. And, you know, the South African public at large have always been denied the opportunity of owning property and are having property registered in their own name. And the value of a title deed, I think, has been maybe underestimated to a large extent, because there's tens of thousands of people who own property who have not been issued with title deeds. I mean, if I think about the West Bank community, if I think about the Delft community, if I think about so many different communities in the Western Cape, who people don't have title deeds and who don't appreciate the value of the title deed. So when you expose yourself so eloquently on all of the things that you have to go through in doing the completeness and the regularization of a title deed, I don't know if we always appreciate, you know, the value of title deeds, and because people have, you know, just we've always been second-class citizens, and, you know, we had to come by with what we come by with. And so, you know, are you seeing a better appreciation for title deeds, and that people actually understand the value and the worth of their title deeds? Just dealing with some of the community people in the Blue Downs Easter of area.
So you're asking my personal opinion. Maybe I should keep that to myself. But in general, title deeds are, it's a psychological advantage, if you want to call it that. If you know that you have a house that is registered on your name, and you know that nobody can evict you out of that house, and it is yours, and if you decide to sell it, it is yours. And it's registered in the deeds office. That's called a real right that is registered in the deeds office. It gives you that psychological advantage over, you know, so you walk around with a bit of a confidence, if you want to call it that. It gives you confidence and
peace of mind.
Peace of mind, yes. So that when you sleep at night, nobody is going to remove you out of your...
You know, in Afrikaans, there was a spreekwoord that said, yes, he koki dani froki. And I'm not sure how true it still is today, where, yes, you know, people used to pride home ownership and owning your own property. That didn't matter how big or small it was. You know, you had that sense of pride when you owned your own property, and you could lay your head down at night and say, this may is, and so on. And as you said, that peace of mind and that confidence that comes with that. But Mr. Hendricks, there's a lot that goes into owning property and acquiring the properties. So when you are seeing your purchases coming forward, you know, the whole issue of costs, that there's costs that must be paid in the transfer process. You know, the purchaser has to pay the transferring attorney's fees whilst the seller has appointed the transferring attorney to do the registration and to put the property onto someone else's name. The purchaser pays for those costs.
So in a normal transfer, What is a normal transfer? So in a conventional transfer, somebody that owns a house and he doesn't have a bond, he then appoints the attorney to do the transfer. The purchaser pays the costs related to the transfer, and the obligation of the seller is then to pay the estate agent. So if there's a sale of R1 million, all that he and the estate agent must get R50,000 from that. He gets a clean R950,000 to his account. My job as the conveyancer is then to retrieve costs for my fees from the purchaser. So okay. My bill goes to the purchaser, even although my client is the seller. So with regards to selling of property, yes, in general. But in the Blue Downs, Delft, East River area, it is slightly different because there's people have received properties from the city of Cape Town, and in terms of housing projects, then there's a preemptive right that has been inserted in there.
Okay.
As in where the preemptive right then says once the thing is registered in your name, you cannot transfer it until 8 years has lapsed. Within that 8 years, if you want to sell, you must ask us to waiver our right. So we then do an application to the city of Cape Town for this waiver. They then give us the waiver and we must remove the restrictive condition in the title deed. That costs the seller a fee to remove that title deed.
Okay. But okay. It's just for the ability
to remove
sell,
the restriction,
to
yes.
Sell the
and sometimes they've lost the title deed as well, and we must do a lost copy application, which is another costs.
Okay, and
cost
I think
to the seller. So
and hence my question, do people value the value of the title deed? Do they actually understand getting that piece of paper is not getting your rent paper, it's not getting electric paper. This is actually the papers of the house, and to replace that is extremely expensive and also is going to be time-consuming.
So a lot of people don't appreciate that, because if you look at how they neglect their houses, if you have a title deed, this is your asset, so you're going to look after your asset. If you have a car, you're going to polish it, you're going to wash it, you're going to look after it.
Yes.
Okay? So I don't see people looking after their houses, or not many people looking after their houses. When I drive through Delft area, and I do see some people with their gardens, fancy gardens, and painting their houses. But mostly people neglect their houses. I've been to a house in but this was a deceased estate. I think it was 2 weeks ago. The person passed away 12 years ago. So the person in the house didn't have any reason to look after the house. The wind after 12 years has blown the sand away from the foundation. Simple things like that where you have to ensure that there's grass growing around the house, etc., etc.
And now you've got structural damage because...
Possible structural damage in the future, yes.
Okay. So there's a lot of education that needs to be done among our people, and obviously taking the word out into the community. This is why...
I don't think it's really education. I think it's maybe... self-pride and house pride.
Well, that comes through education, Mr. Hendricks. I think when you educate people, you also teach them about their dignity and their own worth, and, as people, what they're worth. And that comes through education. You have to effectively raise the standard of people's understanding of themselves and the environment in which they live. We can't just get up in the morning and think that we're just existing, So, obviously education is part of that process of schooling them and of, bringing that knowledge to them about, the value of the possession, the value of the roof. Tell them, if you neglect this house, it's not your house, but if you neglect the house, where are you going to be staying in a year's time? The roof is going to fall down. Where will you be living? So he understands that language. So you have to maybe bring it down in a lower understandable level, but that they can comprehend that they have value by having a roof over their head. Mr. Hendricks, just in terms of some of the compliance issues that they have to go through, you figure the client, you understand, the client, where the client is coming from, you've gone to SARS, and you've applied for the transfer duty certificate from SARS. What are some of the issues that you've encountered with the SARS applications? Is there anything that you want to raise as a caution to your clients when going to SARS and saying, look, I'm transferring, I need... let's say, for example, the wife isn't working, so she doesn't have a tax number. The husband is working, and then, what are the issues around the SARS application?
So a few issues over the past years that I've been a conveyancer has raised the heads, and that if you if you are indebted to SARS or you've not filed your tax returns, then they will make an assessment, and the assessment will lay there until either you are called up for an audit or something pops up on the system. And when we do the application for a transfer duty certificate, this pops up on the system, then they could communicate with me to say, you must collect X amount of money or withhold X amount of money or pay over X amount of money to us. So if they issue me with that directive, because it's a directive in terms of the act, if I disregard that, the act says, if you disregard this, they can hold me criminally liable and they can collect the monies from me personally.
Oh, my word. So that's very serious.
That is very serious.
For the conveyancer. So you're almost becoming that SARS agent.
There you go.
And I think the important thing is, obviously at StartProp, we train our agents to talk to the clients and see that their tax affairs are in order, that they have filed returns. In fact, our deed of sale and offer to purchase is written there that both the buyer and the seller warrant that their tax affairs are in order. And it's important that the agent sits with the client and explains that to them, that, you know, we're going to go to SARS, your tax affairs must be in order, SARS will not grant us a certificate to transfer the property unless you have regularized that. So, but I didn't realize that SARS is actually making you personally liable for failure to comply with the directive to collect tax from a client. So if a client owes SARS $200,000 and you fail to pay that money over, they can then pursue you for that money.
So on our computer systems, on our computer systems, there's a specific, in our transfer duty application, there's a specific block that we have to make certain, declarations in our applications, but there's a specific block that you have to highlight whether the person is in the country or not. If the person is a non-resident and is selling his property and the property is valued over 2 million rand and the person hasn't paid their taxes up to date, I am obliged to hold, I think it's 25% or 15% of the transaction. So I have in my trust account a few...
15%.
A few 15%ers.
Yes.
That I'm obliged to hold. I'm holding it. And it's a couple of years now already. I'm holding it.
Okay. So that's the foreign tax withholding. Yeah.
Yes. So until the person that is overseas has declared their tax indebtedness to SARS and they've taken this document to SARS, they can, and SARS gives me the instruction to release the monies to the people or pay the monies to them. But I'm sitting there with... Mine is in my trust account, unfortunately.
Wow. Mr. Hendricks, just before we took a break earlier, I said to the clients that, you know, one of the things you need is a rates clearance certificate, and that the client must have their rates up to date, the water, electric, all the municipal accounts must be up to date. Otherwise, they can't transfer the property. We need that rates clearance to say that all your rates affairs are in order. What happens if the client doesn't have the money to pay? Let's say they owe the City of Cape Town 28,000 rand, which is their rates and outstanding water and all the other bills that they've accumulated over a period of time. They now owe 28,000 rand. They don't have the money. They're actually selling their house because things are going tough. Is there a way that we can, how do we get this 28,000 solved? Is there a way that you guys are...
So we need this rates clearance certificate on our file. If we do not have it on our file, in my lodgement cover, I cannot lodge without this rates clearance certificate. There's an application that we can do too, but we need specific instructions from the client, where we say to the City of Cape Town, we undertake to pay you this 28,000 rand, this indebtedness that the person has, on registration of the transfer. So once the money is then reflected in our trust account, we then, before the payment to the, in fact, the first payment that we make, we undertake to pay SARS the indebtedness. Not SARS, the City of Cape Town, the indebtedness.
So is this a new development? Because I know before... the client had to go and lend that money and bridge the money. But is this a new development with the city where they're accepting a guarantee or undertaking from an attorney?
No, it's not new. It's been around for the past good couple of years already.
Okay. So the client doesn't have to go to a bridging company and have bridging finance to settle the
outstanding
rates.
There's an admin fee that we charge. All attorneys do charge this admin fee because it's a bit of a... So it will take one person in the office maybe a few hours to put all those documents together and then... and he has to consult with the seller, and the seller has to give him specific instructions.
Okay, then just do the application to the city, and then
so
the
it's a small nominal fee that we charge.
Yes, but you will launch an application to the city to and issue the city with an undertaking that on the sale of the property they will get paid whatever the outstanding rates and then they will issue the certificate now.
They will issue the certificate now.
That is fantastic, Mr. Hendricks. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to talk about some of the compliance certificates and is that absolutely necessary and who's going to fund this compliance certificates in the transfer process. We're going to be listening to Universal Tribe with Galaxy Sax Divino.
Tune in to the Startprod Property Show every Wednesday from 12 p.m. to 1 p.m. Startprop, the property professionals.
We'll be right back.
Start Property Show every Wednesday from 12 p.m. to 1 p.m. Start Prop, the property professionals.
Ja mense, dis al weer Woensdag en dis altyd, soos elke Woensdag, Start Prop Property Show tussen 12 uur en 1 uur hier op Radio Eerste Rivier. Ons stasie, ons talent, ons mense. Live streaming to you from Radio Eerste Rivier en also from Cape Flats Radio. Hoe kwaai is die? Ons is nou op Cape Flats Radio, mense. This is the Start Prop Property Show in studio with Rifaan Hendricks from Hendricks Incorporated Attorneys talking about all things related to the transfer of the property and the process that's involved and all the responsibility.
Where's the questions?
I am Ivan Nietling, the principal of Start Prop Real Estate, and we are at shop number 5, Rose Center in Blue Downs. We are also in Milton Road in Goodwood and then also in the main road in Birkfleet. And also in Gordons Bay Road in the Strand. Come and pop into our offices. Ons is meer as gretig en gewillig om met julle te gesels, man. Ons kan so a kopie koffie meedeel en net gesels oor real estate. And when you're investing into property, you need a bond. You're looking for someone, a competent company to sell your property. Get you the best value, get you the best price. Come and talk to Start Prop, this property professionals. Mr. Hendricks, we're talking about, you know, the conveyancing process, the transfer, the guy's selling his house, the person is wanting to know, when can I move in? How long does that conveyancing process take? I know, you know, how long is a piece of string. But the thing is, in the normal course, you know, if an estate agent is doing the deal, you the transferring attorney, you're largely responsible. Once the deal has been purchased, the purchaser has signed, the seller has signed, it goes to the attorney. How long does that process normally, what would you say is a good time frame to advise the client? Remember, the purchaser must now give notice where they're staying. They're renting a place, they want to give notice there. The landlord is maybe putting them under pressure to sign another lease, and they're saying, look here, we can't sign another lease, we're moving because we bought the house now. Then the seller is also obviously now waiting on their money to come, and they're moving into another house. And the timing of this thing, you know, is it months, is it weeks? How long, what would you say would be a fair time? I'm not going to ask the listeners to hold you to that, but what would you say is a fair time that you would ask, you'd advise the estate agent to say in terms of transferring this process?
If all the stars align, if I get the file and all the stars are aligned in the file, it can take us under a month and we can be registered.
Okay. Whoa, under a month?
Because the first thing that we now do is we capture it, we do the rates clearance application.
Yes.
We pay the rates, we get that within, we get our rates clearance certificate within 3 weeks, or 2 weeks, say 3 weeks, and then we can lodge within that time, after that time, and we can be registered within a month. It can okay. be registered. If the stars all align, but we're dealing with people, okay, and every transfer. Different transfer has different circumstances. Every person has a different circumstance.
Yes.
So we have to get bond cancellation figures, and that takes some time. We have to wait for the purchaser to get his bond approval, and that takes some time. So whilst we are, when we get it, we rush to do certain things, but we rush to wait, actually.
Okay. So you said there's going to be a delay. So on average, we're advising our clients, you know, this is taking about 2 months to get the registration and transfer through. To get all the ducks and everything, all the, you know, all the box ticked and that.
Sorry to cut you words in. So the rates clearance certificate gives you 3 months within which to register.
Okay.
From the date that they issue the rates clearance certificate. And if you register within, let's say, a month and a half, you then get a refund. So you have to pay the 3 months up front. And then if it's registered before the time, before the 3 months lapse, then you are, they refund you a certain amount of money from a calculation that they make from when it's been registered. So you have to advise them when it is registered.
Okay. So would you say that the one between a month, 1 month and 2 months is a fee time estimate to advise your client that the transaction is going to take place?
It all depends on the circumstances. So you as the estate agent should know what the personal circumstances of each negotiated contract is. Okay. Is there bond cancellation? Is there a lost title deed? Is there a preemptive right? Is there a FLSP application? Is there a bond application? Is there levies outstanding? You know, all those things.
So
you actually can tell yourself, you as the estate agent can tell yourself, I can't do this within a month, even although I'm going to push the attorney to do it within a month.
Yes.
You then are being obtuse to even think that.
Okay. I understand where you're coming from. And so obviously one has to be mindful of what the specifics are of each transfer that's happening. If you can just tell me, Mr. Hendricks, there was a time when the banks, the issuing of the cancellation, you know, when I'm cancelling my bond, I have a bond, the seller has a bond, they must cancel that bond, and now we're waiting on bond cancellation figures. How much is the bond that we must settle? And then certain banks were taking extremely long and frustrating the process in terms of being able to issue those figures. I don't know if it was mortgage, what was it, SA Home Loans that we were battling with to get figures from. Is that still the case, or have they kind of streamlined that process now?
It still takes some time, but it's mostly it's streamlined. But you get the odd matter that you,
Murphy's Law.
He's always sticking his head out there somewhere.
Okay. And then obviously, if the client has had financial problems, or the bank has, you're dealing with an attorney, perhaps the client was indebted, or you know there was an attachment over the property, all these things are obviously going to delay the transaction, Mr. Hendricks.
Yes, absolutely. So if there's a lien over the property by a bank for some reason or other, and they've taken judgment, and there's an interdict of the property, we have to contact the attorneys and then get that attorneys to then remove the interdict. But their fees have to be paid, and their indebtedness then has to be addressed. So if it's a mortgage bond indebtedness, then obviously the bond cancellation will take care of that. But if it's some other cancellation for some other reason, then we have to address that. If we have to give an undertaking to pay some other indebtedness, then we have to address that with the client, with the seller. And sometimes it has already happened where there's no more equity left in the property. In fact, the seller then has to pay in order to get it released.
Oh my gosh. Okay. Mr. Hendricks, just talking about the title deeds again. One of the things, the documents you need when you're doing the transfer is an original title deed. You were saying that in the Blue Downs area, you have encountered that where people are not looking after or valuing this title deed. What does it cost today and the time to replace a title deed?
It's a funny thing. When you speak to people, they want to hear what they want to hear. So the turnaround time to get a VA, verlore akte, a lost copy title deed, is about 3 weeks. So you first do the application to get a copy of the lost title deed at the deeds office. You then have to advertise the fact that you're going to that this VA process is going to now take place, and that takes you have to contact your local newspaper. You then put this advertisement in there. Then it must lay open for inspection for 2 weeks. Okay, it's a process you have to follow. You have to hand it into the deeds office 2 days before the time before it is advertised, and then you have to wait for the 2 weeks. And anybody
so
can approach the deeds
take
office
up
in order
three
to
3 weeks. And what is the cost of replacing the title deed? What is the charge?
People charge various amounts, but it's all about 5,000 rand.
About 5,000. Oh,
about plus minus. It could be more. It could be less.
Okay, so people value your title deeds, keep it in a safe place. I think we're all learning valuable lessons here. It's going to delay the transfer by at least 3 weeks if you don't have the original title deed.
If I may as well. So when I'm speaking to people, they hear what they want to hear. So I tell them, so I explain to them that in order to transfer your property, you need if you've lost your title deed, you need to go through a specific procedure. And it's called the lost copy title deed procedure. And it's going to cost you 5,000 rand. They then say, oh, I heard by somebody that we can go to the deeds office, you can pay 150 rand or 200 rand, and then you can get a copy of a title deed. When I explain to them this, they are sometimes so adamant because they've heard it from somebody or from some estate agent or somebody that is in the know. When they eventually come back to me with this thing and I tell them what they're going to come back with, then that's a copy for information purposes only. Because when they come with a copy, there's a huge watermark through it that says for information purposes only. You cannot use that to pass transfer of the property.
Okay, so I think people need to take note of that. Guys, you can't go to the deeds office and get a copy of a title deed. You can't also have a photocopy that you kept in the file. Mr. Hendricks is saying that conveyancer, transferring attorney, must have the original title deed. Otherwise, they must pay, as we said, 5,000 rand for a duplicate original to be issued. It's going to take about 3 weeks for that process to happen, and that's going to be a cost for the seller. Mense, bere weg asseblief julle titelaktes. hou dit in 'n baie veilige plek.
If I can just say one circumstance now, the person was murdered in the house about 14, 15 years ago. Eventually now we are registering this deceased estate and the master is now asking for a police report because when she was murdered in the house, the person that murdered her had a bonfire, a part of her body as well, but bonfire with all the papers, title deeds, IDs, divorce certificates, everything was burnt out. And they're asking for something specific and we don't have it. We cannot get it because we don't have locus standi to get it because nobody's been appointed as the executor. So we then have to go through this whole process in order to...
Wow.
So be careful. Beer het weg, so like you said.
Yes. In the old days, they used to have a postbox savings box that they used to keep all their safe, safety possessions in the postbox under lock and key. Today you can't even find a post office. I don't know what people are doing with their safe, with their goods. Mr. Hendricks, yeah, we're nearly there, but just a quick question. I know that, one of the documents or the documents that you do require is a certificate of compliance, a COCs, before you can post transfer. You must have a plumbing certificate, a gas certificate, a solar electrical certificate, and a beetle. When you're selling land, what certificates do you need? Is there any certificates, compliance certificates that you need when you're just selling a plot or selling a piece of land?
Okay, if you're selling a piece of land, you need to then, in the property report that your estate agents go and when they approach the seller, they must do this property report. In the property report, it will say certain things. And one of the questions that the estate agents has to ask is, is there a plumbing point? Is there a water point? Is there electrical point? Is there sewage point? All those things. Once they are... Points, you don't need COCs for points, but you need to have the account numbers for those points so that you can point it out to the purchaser.
Okay.
So for a plot of land, yes. No. For a house, no as well.
Yes, no, we understand.
Dependent, yeah. Okay?
But because now, on a plot, yes. Sometimes when you sell a plot, you can't see where the pig marks were. The pigs.
The beacons.
The beacons, yeah. When the land surveyor went and marked out the plot, then he put the four pigs into the ground, beacons. And if you can't see that beacons, how do you get that established again?
So you as the seller then have to incur the cost of employing the services of a surveyor. He then comes out and takes the coordinates and then he will come along and use these pigs. He then knocks it into the ground. He uses his machinery that he uses, his GPS things, and then he will...
And then he remarks it,
that's right, yes.
Okay, so,
at the cost,
so
of course.
Do you as the conveyancer get involved with any of that, with the marking of the pigs and exactly what was the boundary lines, or when you're selling a plot, do you look at any of that? Do the surveyor put a drawing in there or nothing like that required from your side?
So if it's a plot, we normally get the surveyor general diagram, okay, and we then point that out to the it's not our job to ask the person,
yes,
as the beacon's been. So if you look at your deed of sale, a part of the deed of sale will then say that the purchaser is au fait, he's made sure that all the beacons have been pointed out to him. So the document that he signed will then say that.
Okay, that so is familiar with the
buyer beware, yes, so the buyer should beware. If the buyer then says, I'm not familiar with this, and he then says, in terms of clause 9, he then says, look at the special conditions, which is clause 21. Then you look at the special conditions where he would then say, you would then need to say that the seller must then appoint a surveyor in order to earmark where the beacons are.
I think that's a good one to close the program with today, where we can tell our listeners, guys, if you're trading in land or plots, make sure that you can find the pigs, make sure that there are the three points, the water point, the sewage point, and the electrical point are identified on the plot, and it'll make the job of the conveyancer so much easier and for the process to go through much quicker. And then just in closing, obviously, the City of Cape Town will also not allow you to sell a plot that is not serviced. If you don't have that plot points on there, you will not be able to sell the property. You're not going to get the clearance certificate without having services on your plot. So sale of unserviced land is history, no longer applicable. Guys, we're closing today's program. We are at the top of the hour. It has gone so quickly. Start Prop, our weekly program between 12 and 1 here on Radio Eerste Rivier, the property show from Start Prop. Closing down and... seeing you next week with another exciting edition. Thank you.
Tune in to the Start Proud Property Show every Wednesday from 12 p.m. to 1 p.m. Start Prop, the property professionals.